Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 111 for the 3rd of March, 2024. A week or so ago, Liz and I traveled up to Brooklyn to retrieve this machine from viewer slash customer Henya. This was her primary machine. I don't know how long she's had it. It had been working, and then it stopped. It started doing a lot of things like skipping stitches and things like that. And it did have its fair share of problems, but I wanted to show you a few things on the Model 237. Basically, as a little primer and give you an idea how this particular model works and why I think this is one of the best machines that Singer ever made. Best general purpose domestic machines. I love these. I now own two. I have one that I had showed that I had picked up at a flea market, and I picked up yet another one earlier this week. I found one local. Anyway, Henya's machine, it had a number of issues. Number one, the top cover, the three screws that secure the top cover, it would be one here, and one over here. They were missing. I was able to dig through my collection of hardware, and I had screws that fit properly. They may not be the exact specific screw for this machine, but the thread was right, and they fit into the openings of the holes of the cover. So at least the cover's not flopping around in the breeze anymore. And it had a couple of other issues as well. Let me pull up. Part of her problem for her stitching was the stud for the upper thread tension mechanism. There's supposed to be a nylon portion here that has fins on it that secures the check spring. This was all roached out. I'll put a picture up over here that I had sent Henya showing why her tension was all off. I happen to have a stud that fit. Once again, it wasn't necessarily off of a 237, because honestly, I don't think I've ever parted one out, but it did fit. I did replace the indicator ring on the upper thread tension mechanism, because the plastic ring that goes, this inner plastic ring with the plus and the minus on it, that was in sad shape. These are available brand new, and I keep usually at least, well, I try to keep like a half a dozen. I think I had like four of them left in stock, so I put a new one of those on. Happened to be the right color, too. I wish I had a new numbered dial. Didn't have one, but this one's still functioning, is okay. And I did replace the check spring. Her check spring was broken. Anyway, that took care of the tension problems that this machine had, or at least most of it. Let me turn the machine over. I want to show you something down below. The Model 237 uses this plastic cover for the shuttle assembly. It's hinged here, and it's released with this lever here, which closes, forms like a gate. I'm going to go ahead and pull the bobbin case out of the machine. There, it's removed. And I'll show you how this works. You simply release this tab, and then this all swings down, and it allows you to remove the shuttle from the machine. On Henya's original part, let me pull it up here, the hinge, as you can see here, was broken, and the other side of the hinge was badly cracked. Now, fortunately, this part is still available, brand spanking new. I think about $22.95. I buy them and I keep them in stock. Let me pull one off the wall here. I have two more of them right here. I buy these from Central Michigan Sewing Supplies, and I try to keep them in stock because these machines are getting older. And, like, this machine, I believe, was made in 1969, something like that. So, that's some pretty old, you know, this is some pretty old plastic. And, like, on my personal 237 I've had to replace it. The 237 I just bought this week, I know I'm going to have to replace it. And I've replaced it on a couple of other customer machines. But this, with the, when this being broken and the shuttle doesn't stay in place correctly, it's game over for these machines stitching. But so it's easy to change these out. This little, there's a little lever here. Here, let me move the camera a little bit. Change out is easy. Simply release the tab, open the gate, and then this little lever here, which is spring-loaded, if you push that in, you can get the gate off. It comes off like that. You see, it just hooks onto that. It gathers here, so you can press that in, bring it on, close it up, latch it closed, and it's done. It's a simple, easy replacement, tool-less repair. And we all like tool-less repairs. Okay, so there you can see it was simple enough to do. Anyway, other issues this machine had were all really mostly just a matter of cleaning. Like any other 15-class Singer machine or any other Singer machine, period, you want to get in here, make sure these pivots are clean. If you have an issue with the feed dog height adjustment, like any other 15, that's the screw you would loosen. Get the feed dog in the middle of the uppermost portion of his travel. You can loosen that screw, push the feed dog down, move the linkages around, get the feed dog height correct, then retighten that screw. This was not an issue with this machine, although it has been checked. And then just go through, do your normal. You can do this all in place. Very little of this has to be taken apart to do a good cleaning and lubrication. But what I wanted to also show you is what's going on top of these machines. Before we go too much further, if you hear something happening off camera, that is the lovely and talented Elizabeth working on a very expensive oboe. What kind is it, Liz?
It's a Luray.
It's a Luray oboe. Okay. They sound like ducks that are being assaulted, and I have it on excellent authority that before she makes it sound like a duck that's being molested, she will let us know. Okay, so we're back inside the top end of this 237, and I wanted to explain a couple of things. Now, on my website, and I'll have the links down below, I have an excellent copy of the user's manual for this machine. I have an excellent copy of the service manual for this machine. Plus, I put together a poster size copy of the exploded view of the machine with all of the parts shown. So it's really, really easy to see what's going on. In my never-ending quest to try to make my life easier in the shop, I've had everything from like a 24-inch TV to a Cisco DX70. Now I've got a 32-inch TV mounted up on this swing arm bracket over my bench. There's a little B-Link mini computer attached to the back of the monitor, and I'm able to access the web, do WebEx, do Zoom calls, or pull up, like in this case, a PDF file of a service manual. So I've got the PDF here of the 237 manual up, and here on another tab, I've got the exploded view of the 237. So yeah, this is something, if you've got the way of doing it, I wholeheartedly recommend it, but I understand that most people are not going to be working this way. Something that you might not be aware of is exactly how these 237s work. And I was showing this to Liz earlier, and actually, that was before we went on our caramel macchiato break. Liz is a tea drinker, not a coffee drinker, except when I offer her a caramel macchiato. Then she goes crazy. She loves this stuff. Anyway, I was explaining to her how this particular machine works, and one of the reasons why I absolutely love it. So I figure I'm going to show you guys too, just in case you've never had one of these open and you've never seen one in operation. So let me get the camera so that it's shooting straight down into the top of this machine. All right, as you can see, I've got the machine on the fixture, and it is plugged in at the moment. I'm going to have the foot controller sitting here so I can operate it. I just want to run the machine with the covers off so you can take a look at a couple of things. Now, I've got the stitch width control so that it's in straight stitch mode, but I want you to watch the mechanism. Okay, now pay particular attention to this portion of the mechanism here. You see how that's moving back and forth. I know this is going to be a little bouncy because it's sitting, hanging up over the edge of the bench at the moment. Okay, underneath here on the main shaft, a gear is cut into the main shaft, and I'll put up pictures from the exploded parts diagram as we go along. So you can see down here is where the gear is cut. There's also under here is where there is the mating gear to the gear that engages in the main shaft, and you'll see in the picture that it has a cam on top, and the bolt that runs through that is on an eccentric. It is of paramount importance that you do not ever remove that gear and cam from the machine. The timing on that gear and cam is set at the factory. The gears are lapped in at the factory. The service manual tells you don't do it, because if you get that out of adjustment, getting it back into adjustment is going to be, without whatever Singer has at their factory, is going to be a royal pain in the neck. Now, this driving plate is always in motion, regardless if we are in straight stitch, as we are here, or if we put it into zigzag mode. This is always moving back and forth. This follower that goes inside this cutout portion of the driving plate and follows along is what drives this shaft and this arm. This shaft is what makes the needle bar go left to right for the zigzag. Let me put this into a wide zigzag, and you can see how that's actually moving now based on the position here. And it also moves this arm, which is moving the shaft that comes down and exits on the bottom to drive this arm, which is what drives the entire shuttle mechanism side to side in perfect synchronization with the movement, the side to side movement of the needle bar. This side to side movement of not only just the needle bar, but also the shuttle, is the reason why on these machines you don't have to mess with the upper thread tension when you're doing zigzags. On most machines, when you're doing, especially doing a wide zigzag, you kind of have to play with your upper thread tension a little bit. Not so on machines that use this system where the entire shuttle is moving. Let me bring her back up again. So once again, and I said it before earlier when we were looking at the bottom of the machine, most of the time you don't have to take much apart on these 237s. Yeah, you might want to take some stuff apart in the needle bar box to get some baked on schmoo and dust out of there and some lint out of there. But in this portion of the machine, generally you don't have to take these apart. Now, my machine that I showed, 4 or 5 months ago, it was pretty locked up when I got it. I got that freed up simply by flushing out the upper portion of the machine with a good blast of Kroil. And that freed a lot of it up. And obviously there are certain things I had to take apart. I took the cap off the connecting rod. and got those bearing surfaces cleaned up, and that's actually where most of the problem was. But you don't have to go super deep. You've all seen me take other machines apart down to the last screw. Not necessary on these for the most part. Now, the machine I just bought earlier this week is locked up solid. It's over at our storage area right now. When it comes time to free up that machine, I will definitely shoot video of the entire procedure. Honestly, I don't even know what's wrong with that one yet. But I just wanted to point out, yes, I do have all of the manuals, the operator manual, the service manual, and the exploded view of this machine available on my website, free download, doesn't cost you anything. Please, 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 if you're going to work on a 237, go to my website, download it. If you want to, print it out, do whatever, but read it, especially the portion where they're talking about don't mess with that cam and gear. Please, please, please. If you do mess with it and you screw it up, just know that you have been forewarned. Okay, I'm going to start at straight, and then I'm going to gradually move it to the widest stitch position for zigzag while the motor is moving slowly. I want you to pay attention. I want you to pay careful attention to what's happening over here at the needle bar pivot and what's happening here at the arm that drives the vertical shaft, which moves the which drives the lever down below, which moves the shuttle back and forth. Watch what's happening as I move. The stitch width and the follower block goes farther out on the cam. Here we are at straight. That's the first marked position. We're starting to get a really good measurable zigzag. We're a little farther out, it's about halfway. We're getting some significant movement now, and we're getting a nice wider zigzag, and we're going to go all the way. And there you go. She makes a beautiful zigzag out there. Now, notice, even at the straight stitch, that's oscillating back and forth. So really, when you get down to it, this machine is always zigzagging. It's in a constant zigzag, except the only difference is we have the stitch width set at minimum, so it's a straight stitch. So when we say this is a straight stitch and zigzag machine, it's really just a zigzag that we can make the stitch width zero. Well, here she is, rewired with a new electronic foot controller, and she's stitching up a storm. She's working really, really well. So I'm gonna do a little bit more with her, play around with her a little bit more. But so far, I'm real happy with the way she's coming out. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. We'll see you on the next video.